to see China of 100 years ago, visit Shanghai. China of 500 years ago, go to Beijing. China of 2,000 years ago, come to Xi'an. The ancient city was the capital city of the first dynasty of China, and today is one of the cradles of Chinese culture. The starting point of the Silk Road, Xi'an became fabulously wealthy as a trade center and cultural and religious melting pot for over 1,000 years. Now it is undergoing another renaissance of industrial force as a city of technology, science and education and a gateway to the Great Northwest. Hi, I'm Anita Anthony and you're watching Echo Trek. The Mercedes-Benz F-Cell World Drive is in China, crossing the world's third largest country in the B-Class F-Cell cars. They drove from Shanghai to Beijing, Xi'an and the Gobi Desert towards Kazakhstan. Crossing China was an opportunity for us to shed light on where China is heading and how the fastest growing country can balance its need for economic growth with environmental responsibility. Have a look at the River Ba, where a huge water city development is underway east of Xi'an. This wetland retreat aims to optimize the natural ecological environment of the Shanba Valley. Projects like this are an effort to offset the effects of industrialization.
The Great Wall is the biggest human-made structure of all times. 2,300 years ago, it was already more than 4,000 kilometers long. But China is setting records again. Today, the People's Republic is the world's biggest producer of, for example, crops, cotton, fish, meat, rice, apples, iron, black coal, aluminium, steel. It's a country with endless possibilities and enormous challenges.
Throughout the last 30 years, China has gone through dramatic changes. The country turned from a primarily agricultural economy to one of the leading industrialized nations on the planet. In the last 10 years alone, China's gross domestic product has almost doubled. From 2001 to 2004, 24,000 kilometers of highways have been built and 17,000 kilometers of railways from 2006 to 2011. Every month, a city of the size of New York is built when you combine all urban buildings throughout China. Wang Juliang is an award-winning Chinese photographer and filmmaker. Over the years, he has captured China's most pressing issue. He has documented the effects of industrialization. In his films and photographs, Wang shows the wastelands that the new consumer culture produces right at the edge of Beijing. More than 14,800 tons of garbage pile up every day in China. Wang's work highlights the garbage crisis in cities like Beijing and why the government pushes for incinerators.
From a larger perspective, the immediate impact of art on society can be very minimal, whether that's in China or anywhere else in the world. But art is an important part of our lives. Art can be a catalyst, a promoter of change, and as such is a vital element to our society's progress. So my view on the importance of art is whether or not it can affect our society, our environment, and whether your art can be helpful to others or not.
The Chinese government is determined to pursue the environmental cleanup, even if it means a slowdown in economic growth. Recently, the central government in Beijing announced a 5-year plan to significantly reduce carbon emissions. How realistic is this goal, and will Beijing be able to implement this policy in the vast rural areas of the country? Jonathan Schwartz is an associate professor at the State University of New York and an acclaimed expert in Chinese environmental policies.
The problem is that there is a gap between what the center is asking to have done and what local governments seek to do. Local governments are far more interested in economic growth because this is a source of legitimacy for the leadership and ensures jobs and opportunities for the population at the local level. So there's a gap between what the center is saying and what the local governments are willing to implement. And this is a problem. The central government will have to be very persistent and make this a very high priority if we are going to see any significant changes in the environmental situation in China.
Not long ago, the Gobi Desert here in the northwest of China looked like this. And now, see for yourselves. This is the Dabanchang Wind Power Station, the largest in Asia. China has become world market leader for wind energy. By the end of 2010, nearly 35,000 wind turbines have been installed with a capacity of 75 gigawatts. But according to official sources, nearly half of that energy couldn't be used because the wind power stations have not been properly connected to the grid yet.
This is actually an area of some optimism, I think. The Chinese have jumped into the lead in many aspects of green technology, green energy technology, windmills. Obviously, they are very big into hydropower. If you spend some time in China, you'll see a lot of people riding electric motorcycles. These are examples of efforts being made to actually cut down on the environmentally polluting sources of power, but there is no question that coal must remain the main source of energy, simply because it is abundant, it is cheap, it is readily available. What we would like to see, what would be ideal, is if they could shift to a cleaner coal burning system.
Amongst the many issues that China will face in the future, individual mobility will be key. According to a recent Reuters News report, car ownership is rising. While conventionally powered vehicles are still the norm in fulfilling the need for individual transportation, China's government is heavily investing in alternatively powered vehicles.
And here's another record. In no other country in the world, more cars are sold every year than here in China, more than 16 million. It's a total of 80 million cars so far. But imagine, in the United States and most Western European countries, the number of cars per 1,000 inhabitants is more than 500 compared to 13 here in China. So this number will dramatically increase, and green propulsion technologies like the one I'm using right now will be dramatically important.
Fuel cell technology might very well have a bright future in China. Recently, China launched the first fuel cell powered train. Linde, the hydrogen partner in the Mercedes-Benz F-Cell Wall Drive, just announced that the German company will build and operate a large hydrogen plant in the Chongqing Chemical Park in western China. Mercedes-Benz F-Cell technology is readily available in passenger cars, but also in buses and commercial vehicles. With a drive around the world, Mercedes has proven that the technology easily holds up to everyday use. The key now is to develop an infrastructure of filling stations.
Wir haben das ganz deutlich gesehen.
We saw this clearly in conversations with politicians and at many events that there is a tremendous interest in these cars and in the technology. In particular, young people are really interested in this.
China points out that Europe had an industrial revolution that lasted for 150 years. China's development is unique in history for both its speed and its output of industrial waste. Without a model to follow, China is faced with a difficult question on how to achieve industrialization that is both economically and environmentally sustainable. But the best way to help China is to start living a more environmentally conscious lifestyle right here at home. If we make a conscious decision every day to buy eco-friendly products and support green innovation in our homes, our work, and our lives, then we form the building blocks of a global society that is environmentally aware, and China will follow. This was EcoTrack. See you next week.